you're on the boards. They only allow less than 9 points per game in terms of second chance points. And for Baylor, that's who they are. They rebound 42% of their misses. How many of those can they get tonight, and how many can they convert?
All right, lineups now. And for the Kansas Jayhawks, it goes this way. Tharp, Seldon, Wiggins, Ellis, and Embiid. And for Baylor, Kenny Cherry's been bothered by some turf toe. He's not going to start, so it'll be Franklin, Heslop, O'Neal, Jefferson, and Austin. Ready to go here in Waco. Kansas and Baylor. And Austin tips that one to O'Neal. The Bears control.
In the loss to Texas, Kansas, the first 3 or 4 minutes, I think they set the tone or set the rules of how they were going to play. They didn't guard the ball. They didn't fight it consistently for the entire defensive possession. They got punked around the rim.
There's the lob, and Jefferson throws it down.
That is a great way for Baylor to start a set play. Scott Drew ran set play after set play after set play in Stillwater on Saturday.
It is something that Kansas will try as well against this zone.
It's a 1-1-3 zone that kind of changes to a 2-3. You must flatten it out by getting it to the baseline.
Good hands inside, a deflection and a turnover. One thing to keep in mind, the Bears really shoot the three well, led by Brady Heslop. They shoot it at 40% as a team. Tharp on Franklin. Heslop catch and shoot. That's what he does, Jimmy.
You know, another sign of whether or not you're ready to play. Transition defense and how much daylight do you allow shooters the first 2 or 3 minutes? Way too much for Brady Heslop.
Bill Self didn't feel like his team came ready to play on Saturday in Austin. Suffered their first conference loss.
They go back to that opening play for Baylor. They set the ball screen. With Jefferson, he sets the screen, and then he receives a screen, and the screen never even gets set. That's how much Wayne Seldon fell asleep on the roll to the rim by Jefferson.
Get the foul on Gary Franklin, his first. Tharp high off the window and gets it to go. I think you make the argument Nadir Tharp is their leader. The junior out of Worcester leads him in assists.
I don't think Baylor's a great defensive ball club in their man or their zone. I think if you get that thing to the fourth or fifth or sixth pass on the third side of the floor, you will get a lot of good looks against these guys in white.
Austin looks opposite, gets it to O'Neal. Inside, wouldn't go. Here's Ellis.
Man, O'Neal turned down a wide open jump shot to take it into traffic.
Good look to Ellis, who's fouled by Austin.
And you know what, to me, that foul is on O'Neal because he turns down a wide open shot and now he puts Isaiah Austin in a bad spot to have to recover from behind. That's how the Baylor staff will look at it.
Bill Self, head coach, his 11th year at Kansas, national title in 2008. Leading one of the premier programs at all of college basketball.
John, this is one of his more talented teams just in terms of pure raw talent, but it is not his toughest team, and it is not his best defensive team. And those last two things are a big concern to him to start this game.
Yeah, and it is his youngest. Blocked there by Embiid. Yeah, defense and toughness usually trademark for Bill Self-coached teams.
He can get the ball to the short corner right there and go to work.
Embiid has it blocked. Pass deflected and another turnover. Now they set things up. Here's O'Neal.
Corey Jefferson already 2 or 3 times in this game has drugged Embiid away from the rim as an on-ball screener. You have to do that. You cannot allow Embiid to camp out around the rim. Drag him away and make him move.
No miscommunication there. Franklin was trying for a lob. Ellis steps back. and buries it over Hessler.
So he shoots a high percentage. And anytime he leaves his hand, it looks good. And I think you try to get that guy going early. Maybe Kansas' most consistent player night in and night out.
Hessler feed to Jefferson. Austin back to Jefferson, who puts it home. Corey Jefferson took that big step last year, and they need him to have a big game here tonight.
You know, Baylor really struggled, especially in the first half against Kansas in Lawrence, with the length of Kansas around the rim.
And there's Perry Ellis again, another bucket, and he's got six.
Sonny does so many things well. He can stick an open 15, 16 footer. He can put it on the deck for two bounces very efficiently, doesn't over dribble. He's a key for Kansas come March.
Austin, contested by Embiid, still gets it to go.
Well, I like how Baylor has started this game. Yes, Heslop knocked down a three, but they are making a point to throw that thing inside. If they flip the switch and start doing it on a consistent basis, they can get right back towards that 500 mark in Big 12 play.
Scott Drew is Rico Gathers set to check in. Ellis trap, turns it over. O'Neal. And Wiggins gathers it in. Tharp has been a pretty reliable shooter this year, not able to hit in that spot. And Jefferson on the lob, second time that they've been able to connect with number 34.
And there we have it. I've already said it. A pure sign of, are you ready to play, what your transition defense look like, and how much daylight do you give jump shooters. Kansas has failed in those two areas the first 5 minutes of this game.
Seldon has it knocked out of bounds. Kansas basketball when we return. Baylor off to an 11-8 lead. And they've been getting looks close to the hoop. Can't get much closer than this. Corey Jefferson with two.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by the Quicksilver Card from Capital One. Earn 1.5% cash back on every purchase. And DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you gotta get DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
Back in Waco, Baylor by three. And these teams heading in different directions. You know, you look, if it were a stock, Baylor on January 6th ranked as high as seventh. It's going in the wrong direction. Meanwhile, Kansas, thanks to winning 7 of 8, they've climbed up to number 8. And Baylor is unranked. Kansas playing very good basketball despite the fact that they lost on Saturday. So going in different directions. I like it. Jayhawk market, Bear market.
Well, these are the two most talented teams in the Big 12. And Baylor has top 25 talent, size, experience, and depth. But they have played like a team with a top 300 urgency and heart up until the game Saturday in Stillwater. But they can get that turned around.
Kenny Cherry has checked into the game, been bothered by a turf toe injury. Been a starter for most of the season. Let's join the third member of our team tonight, Jeff Goodman.
Guys, I talked to Scott Drew right before tip, and he said that Cherry, who missed last game with that turf toe, will be limited today. He'll probably play about 15 or 20 minutes, look good in pregame shoot around, and is expected to play again a limited role tonight.
Now, Jimmy, you were in Stillwater on Saturday, and they won that game without Cherry, who's really their only true point guard.
Absolutely, and in his absence, Gary Franklin was outstanding. He went a long time in that game. Franklin did with only one turnover. He made three huge three-point shots down the stretch. The ball moved well, and the ball has moved well so far tonight for Baylor. They made five shots, all five of them off of an assist.
And again, Cherry bothered by turf toe. And we will keep an eye on his mobility here in this one. Seldon with a size advantage. He's been on Heslop for most of this game. Shot clock at 6. Jefferson. And flying in for the board is Jamari Traylor. Oh, Embiid lost the handle Nope, they're going to say a foul. They get Gathers with a foul. I thought they were just going to say it went out of bounds. So Rico Gathers charged with his first. Scott Drew doesn't like the call.
John Embiid puts so much pressure on the defense quickly. He's like a point guard that can put it on you with the ball in his hands. This guy puts it on you with his speed to the front of the rim. Very difficult to stay up with this cat.
One of the things that happened last Saturday in the Kansas loss in Austin, both Embiid and Wiggins really struggled. And right there, the freshman Embiid picks up an offensive foul.
Talking about setting the rules of the game, Baylor has sent the message, we're going to trap every time the ball gets to the short corner or the corner. And Kansas has now turned it over twice. They know the trap's coming. They talked about it in walkthrough. But they're waiting for the trap to choke the life out of them before they reverse the basketball.
Embiid was double-teamed very infrequently last weekend against Ridley and company. It's a Texas team that's got a lot of size. Most nights, though, he has to handle a lot of double teams.
Yeah, well, because the league is really pretty small, with the exception of Baylor and Texas and Kansas.
Yeah, the rebound there, ripped down by Tarik Black. Good look inside. Trailer lays it in.
Yeah, Baylor not getting their zone defense set. And they've played it 46% of the time Baylor has so far this season. This is something they should have corrected by now.
Foul on Nadir Tharp. And that is his first. Gary Franklin checking back in along with Austin. Tharp will grab a seat.
And I think anytime Brady Heslip goes out, it's advantage the other team. Because he puts so much pressure and stress on you as a shooter. He's going to become a lethal screener, if not the best screener in the Big 12. And he stretches you defensively. So when he sits down, Kansas takes a deep sigh breath.
Scott Drew gets timeout. These two teams met January 20th in Lawrence. Heslop knocked down 6 3-pointers in that one. Baylor, the early lead. Conference play continues. Thursday night showcase doubleheader on ESPN at 7, number 22, UConn on the road, taking on 7th-ranked Cincinnati. And then at 9 in the Pac-12, it's Oregon and number 2, Arizona. Thursday night showcase presented by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups. And only 2 unbeatens left because on Saturday, Cal and Arizona, Justin Cobb's a fadeaway. And Cal upsets Arizona, and they storm the court in Berkeley.
Well, Arizona loses, actually. You and I saw Cal out of Maui, and I think when we left the island, we felt like that was going to be a darn good basketball team in the Pac-12, but they have not played well or up to their potential until that game.
Our game here, the Bears and the Jayhawks. Baylor just 2-6 in conference and desperately needing a win, coming off that victory in Stillwater on Saturday. That wouldn't go for Torian Prince. And the other way, Kansas a chance to take the lead.
Boy, Wiggins got bailed out because his guy just blind cut him right to the rim, just missed a layup.
Wiggins hasn't tried a shot yet in this game.
Baylor plays this zone 46% of the time, and Kansas shoots 47% against zones on the year. So it is a gamble to throw this zone defense at him.
Fans wanted to travel. Trailer was able to gather it in and lay it home.
No, he didn't travel. It looked a little awkward. There was 1-2 up into a shot. Trying to look out there right now without Embiid on the floor. I call him not a game changer. He's a court changer. The floor looks different when Embiid's not out there. That's the impact that he has in this league and will have in that NCAA tournament. Maybe the only guy I would describe like that.
Cherry launching with a shot clock winding down. An offensive rebound putback wouldn't go for Gathers, but he'll shoot two. That's what he does so well. So physical down low.
He changed the game in Stillwater when he stole the ball, dunked the ball off his forehead, and showed his guns running to the huddle. My favorite play of the year so far in college basketball.
John Chomby, Jimmy Dykes, Jeff Goodman back here at the Farrell Center at Waco. Super Tuesday, Kansas by a point. Here tonight, Andrew Wiggins, very quiet. How quiet? He hasn't even attempted a shot. And in fact, last Saturday in the loss against Texas, Wiggins had his worst shooting game. 2 out of 12, had only 7 points. And tonight just hasn't gotten himself the basketball in a good spot to launch.
Well, when you break down Wiggins' game on synergy, he's a dynamic player in transition. He's shooting almost 70% in transition, and he gets a free throw attempt 32% of the time in transition play. So that's where he's at his best. He's just a 32% true jump shooter on the year. Now, he's a little bit better catch and shoot at 38%, where off the dribble, he's 24%. So this zone right now has probably gotten into Wiggins a little bit. He knows as a jump shooter that's not his strength. So he's going to have to play through it. The great ones find a way to get to their spot anyway in the course of a ball game. And I think this kid's a great.
Let's go to Jeff.
I talked to both Andrew Wiggins and Bill Self. They both said Andrew has been more assertive over the last couple weeks, and you can see it with his body language, just the way he moves around the court. Tonight, he looks more passive, and that's been a key with him throughout really his college career so far, his short college career. He's got to be more assertive. Bill Self knows it. He's trying to get it out of him consistently.
Kansas is interesting offensively. In the big picture, they don't have trouble scoring. This team can score. You're talking about around 80 points a game, but they don't have a true go-to guy, at least not yet.
And because they score the ball so well, those first 7 games in conference play, they won, and the entire time their defense was slipping. And Bill Self kept talking to them about it, and then they get stung in the nose by Texas. And has a reality check taken hold of these guys on the other end of the floor?
Inside, big Tarik Black able to put it home.
Well, they are so good, talking about Kansas, throwing that thing around the rim. That's why I still trust them as much as anyone in the country to win the entire thing. They understand the importance of defending the rim and scoring at the rim.
Heslop gets a good look at it. And Wiggins the rebound.
Remember, he gets fouled at a high rate in transition.
Black inside, couldn't finish. Inside again, blocked. And they're going to go to the possession arrow. It'll stay with the Jayhawks. Tarik Black started his career at Memphis. Royce O'Neal checking back in.
When I break Kansas down on film, they are a layup and dunk team at their core. And they've scored, you know, 50 points in the paint 4 or 5 times already this year. That's more than the rest of those Big 12 teams combined for the most part. There's no answer for them inside strength.
Trailer with the left hand came up a little short. Jayhawks by a point here in Waco.
Now Mason, a smaller defender. He's given away probably 3 or 4 inches to Heslop. But he's a bulldog. He's a fighter.
Push up ahead. Seldon tried to throw it down and gets fouled hard by O'Neal. Seldon aggressively at the rim.
John, it does you no good. It does you no good if you're playing Kansas to send your guards as a half-man rebound. You have to settle in this ball game if you're Baylor with we're sending 2 or 3 to the offensive glass, whatever it is, and those other two dudes got to be on a dead sprint. They can't be in no man's land, because if not, Kansas is going to be at the rim on you with 31 or 32 on the shot clock.
Boy, just snuck out. And Gathers will grab a seat. Seldon, as we showed you on Saturday, had a very strong game in the loss against Texas, and his scoring continues to climb. In conference play, is their second leading scorer. Missed them both. O'Neal. Seldon the other way. Baylor's missed 7 straight shots. Trailer couldn't handle the offering of Tarik Black. Oh, Austin with the left hand putback wouldn't go.
A really hard shot by Austin. He had time to rebound that basketball with two hands and then, you know, re-elevate.
Tharp from way downtown buries it. Nadir Tharp has made great strides shooting the basketball. Field goal percentage up from 34% to 48% this year, and even better on threes.
I can't think of a better shooting point guard that Bill Self has ever had at Kansas, just in terms of a pure three-point stroke.
We're going to get the foul on Mason.
That's what I talked about with Mason. He's a fighter and a bulldog defender. Heslop's body is pretty strong as well, and Heslop did a good job of seeking the contact off the ball. We talk about that a lot when you have the basketball. Heslop's a smart, smart kid in terms of fighting for his feet as a shooter. That's where it all gets set up.
Gary Franklin handling the ball again. The injury to Kenny Cherry that will limit his minutes at turf toe. Heslop, another good look at it.
Great example of fighting for his feet. The feet got set, and from that point, it's over. It's going to be splash at the bottom because Mason, I'm not sure if he tried to shortchange it or shortcut it, but you have to tag Heslop and chase his numbers all over this floor.
Black powers his way to the bucket, and it's Kansas by three.
How many shots has Kansas gotten right around the rim in this game? Oh, other side. I talked about the height differential between Mason and Heslop, and that's showing up. Mason was privy. He was almost there on the catch, but Heslop still saw the rim. Again, fighting for his feet as a shooter, and he's winning that battle.
Tied up at 19 here in Waco. Tharp not able to answer Heslop, and then a foul inside on Austin. Well, remember, the first time these two teams got together, Brady Heslop knocked down 6 3-pointers. Off to a good start tonight, Jimmy.
Watch the feet of Brady Heslop. He gets to the corner, boom. Once the feet are set, the battle has been won. Great shooters fight for their feet. It lines up everything else.
Steve Weiss and Miles Simon in studio on ESPNU right now. Ole Miss at Kentucky. Wildcats won their last 7 home meetings against the Rebels. Now Alex Poitras doing big things.
Yeah, whenever Poitras plays well, can bodes well for the Wildcats.
1-point lead there. Meanwhile, on ESPN, Ohio State and Iowa check out Amir Williams.
Well, that's a scoring outburst. 21 points in the first half.
Back to Don and Jimmy.
All right, coming up tomorrow, ESPNU, all-day coverage of the 2014 National Signing Day. Best high school football players in the land. They will announce their commitments across the country. ESPNU National Signing Day tomorrow at 8 a.m. Inside, Perry Ellis able to put it home. Now Ellis with a good start to this one, 8 points. And Perry on the season averaging 13. He's their second leading scorer.
On Kansas shoots a high percentage, about 60% on shots around the rim. And Baylor continues to give them shots around the rim.
How about Mason contesting the lob effort with Jefferson? Giving up about 9-10 inches there. Shot clock at 7. Heslop fires.
You got to step up. You cannot think I've got him covered. You have to step up and meet him on that ball screen.
Yeah, it almost seemed Tarik Black was honoring that he might put it on the floor and try and go around him.
That's fine. Let him do it. Let him do that. Don't let him beat you doing what he does best. What I'm talking about, Tarik Black, the ball screen's coming. You can see it. You're behind the play, Tarik Black. And this is a shooter. Step up. That's too much daylight. You have to step one step up and make him go around you because you know he can beat you shooting threes. Baylor team with a lot more fight and a lot more energy than last week. I was watching Miles Simon call the game here last week against West Virginia. He had a great replay of all 5 guys from Baylor standing and watching instead of playing with an urgency and an effort about him. He described him well. But at Oklahoma State and so far in this game, they have flipped the other switch.
Heslop off the mark. He has scored the last nine for Baylor. Embiid back in. Can't hit in that spot. Well, they go to the possession arrow. This time it belongs to Baylor. Joel Embiid still everything almost is new to him. As a young guy, his first trek through major college basketball, continues to study the Hakeem Olajuwon films. I love visiting with this guy. He told me earlier today his favorite class is math. Loves numbers. I said that will come in handy because you're going to have a lot of money to count one of these days, young fella.
Foul inside on Kansas. And they'll get Embiid, and that will be his second. For more on Joel Embiid, here's Jeff Goodman.
Joel Embiid, only been playing for a couple of years, guys. I spoke to him earlier and asked him a little bit about the NBA with all the speculation that he could be the first overall pick. And he said he's leaning towards or certainly thinking about coming back to school.
They get the violation and the turnover. And it's Baylor basketball. So it looks like, at least right now, he's saying that he may come back, Jeff.
Well, he's saying his parents aren't in desperate need money-wise back in Cameroon. And he's a kid who said, listen, I'm not sure I'm ready for the NBA right now after this year. But again, it's hard to turn down if he is going to be the number one pick, $3 or $4 million a year.
Pretty much every GM is screaming at the television, well, at least the guys that are in the lottery, you're ready, you're ready, come out. Heslop, that one partially deflected by Seldon. Inside, Gathers had it blocked. Tharp goes left hand and gets it to go.
Yeah, Kansas is really doing a good job of running it right up the backside of Baylor in their transition defense. You know, if you're an NBA scout and you continue to carve into that time that you spend on the road to evaluate Joel Embiid, you're wasting your time. That's what a number one pick looks like. And you're basing it on what's he going to be able to do for you 4 or 5 years from now and then over the next 10 years. And that's the guy.
Fight for the loose ball. Heslop comes away with it. Bears up by one as we close into the four-minute mark. That one deflected by Wiggins. Goes right at Franklin. No foul called. And a putback there by Tharp.
See, that was an equal opportunity rebound for the other eight guys on the floor. Two guys were involved in the play, but there was three blue jerseys there to clean it up and not a white jersey in sight. And that's kind of reverting back to why Baylor started 1-6 in Big 12 play. A lack of urgency.
Franklin finds Gathers, who's hammered, and he'll go to the line. Our under four timeout in Waco, and a good one. 1-point game. Jayhawks lead.
Steve Weissman here, coming up on the Land Rover Halftime Report. Iowa looking to stay within sight of a Big Ten title, but Aaron Kraft with 11 early. Let you know if that's enough for the Buckeyes so far. Plus, the number three team in the country adding a McDonald's All-American. Miles Simon on what the addition of Chris Walker means for Florida. That's all coming up at the half. Now back to John and Jimmy.
All right, Steve, thanks. Back here in Waco, and Baylor within a point. All right, now check this out. Scott, you're getting Gary Franklin's attention.
Watch what happens. He turns around. What did you say, Coach? Boom. And Andrew Wiggins says, thank you very much, and goes down and misses the layup, but Kansas cleans it up. That turnover is on Scott Drew. And it's really there's really three parts to the play, but Scott Drew can't stop his point guard in the first half and have him look back for a play call. You've got to communicate that a lot quicker. Secondly, Franklin, if that does happen, when he stops to look back, he's got to cover up the basketball and protect it. Thirdly, Wiggins was very alert to see that it's there for the taking. So there's three parts of that play, but ultimately it goes back to Scott Drew not communicating early.
Got to make it quick. Wiggins, by the way, for all the talk about him offensively, he's an excellent defensive player. Here's Tharp, flips it up and in.
What a cut by Nadir Tharp. When you talk about cutting and hooking and looking and showing your hands on the cut, all the things you teach, Tharp just did as a scoring point guard inside that zone.
He's got 11, Nadir Tharp. Grant's looking for some help. Eddie Travel.
When Nadir Tharp cuts through this zone, out top, watch what he does. He's going to watch his hands. Boom, right there. Show it. Catch it. Stop and pop. He got himself under control off of a really hard cut. A lot of guys will cut that hard, John, and look also kind of continue to float on their shot. He cut, stopped, and popped it up.
Here's the lob the other way, and oh, Kansas, or I should say Baylor, able to sniff it out, and then gathers, bang that one off the Kansas player, Tarik Black, and it ends up a Baylor basketball.
Is that off of his dome?
I believe it was.
And it didn't even faze him.
That one off of Wiggins out of bounds. It stays Baylor basketball.
Watch the save here.
Right shoulder, maybe.
No, no, got him right off
right
the
off
face.
His face. Black just turns the other end. No expression. Tough guy. Too much space.
That's looking a really good look at it. Seldon, Ellis up ahead.
John,
10
where,
for Perry Ellis.
Where is Gary Franklin when Heslip rises up to shoot? He's watching the action instead of on a dead sprint to half court and then read what happens from there.
Franklin finds Gathers and one. Rico Gathers to the line. I mean, that body on this guy, able to absorb the contact. Gathers, he goes 6'8", 270. Native of Louisiana and a second cousin of the late Hank Gathers.
I look at him like I look at Brady Heslip. Anytime Gathers is not on the floor, it's advantage the other team because of how you just described him. He's 6'8", 270. He's got a mean streak and only shoots a little over 40% from the field, but he puts pressure on you at the rim. He's a tough guy that will fight for deep post touches. No one else on this Baylor team will do it consistently.
Brandon Green in the game. He's got the basketball. Now gives off Tharp. See if Kansas can get Wiggins going. Wiggins missing there. Out of bounds. And it'll be Baylor basketball. Scott drew one of the offensive foul as he ran over Torian Prince.
Terry goes left to come back right. And that's how they start a lot of their plays.
Gathers on the move, wouldn't go. Green stepped in the baseline. 1:25 to go here in the first half, and it's Kansas by deuce.
Well, you would think about subbing Heslip, wouldn't you? For an out-of-bounds play right now, the way he shot that ball.
Heslip with a dozen all on three-pointers here in the first half. Wiggins with a steal. Lost a handle for a quick second.
It's a really good job by Wiggins to run to where the habit pass is going to be thrown.
Nadir Tharp having a first half. 14 points for the junior. And it's Kansas by five.
Now, when I saw Kansas lose at Colorado, I wasn't convinced their point guard spot was good enough to win the national title with. But now it is. Tharp and Mason are good enough for Kansas to cut down the nets.
And Cherry found Gathers and gave him a pretty good pass. And then they get the foul on Prince. The last weekend, Embiid and Wiggins struggled against Texas. Kind of more the same here tonight.
exactly more of the same tonight. They were more productive against Texas to this point. Now we expect Wiggins to be a lot closer to a finished product than he's even capable of being. And like Jeff talked about, Embiid's only been playing basketball since he was 16 years old. So because of that, Bill Self's going to have to maneuver through this league maybe two, three games at a time with those guys not putting up points.
One-and-one spot here for Tharp. 80% free throw shooter.
Good as Baylor, offensive rebound percentage, the best in the league at 42%. Get it up with about 5 seconds to go, enough to give you a chance to get one back, but don't let Kansas get the last shot of this half. It would be a deal breaker if that happens.
Let's see if they can get Heslop free somewhere. Oh, turnover. Now Wiggins from half court. Got it! A deal breaker. How's that for your first points of the half?
Just what I said Baylor could not afford to do. You turn that thing over and you allow Kansas to get the last shot of the half. Yeah, it's not a great shot, but you know what? It is for Andrew Wiggins. Remember this at the end of the ball game. Baylor does not close out the first half. And Kansas says thank you very much.
Let's go over to Jeff Goodman.
Bill, Andrew Wiggins struggled in that first half, but he hits that final shot. You think that'll get him going in the second?
We should have run that play for him earlier, I guess. I hope so. You know, he's playing well defensively. We're actually guarding well. We just couldn't guard Brady, but we're being pretty competitive and doing a good job on the boards right now.
How important is the play of Nadir Tharp for your team?
Oh, it's imperative that he plays well, and everyone needs to play well, though. But certainly the way Baylor kind of distorts their zone, it'll be a different guy, you know, each and every night, because they can take somebody away.
Thanks, Bill.
35-27 at the break as Bill Self's Jayhawks finish on a 10-2 run thanks to this three. Land Rover Halftime Report, Steve Weissman and Miles Simon in studio.
All right, John, this is the Land Rover Halftime Report. What a way to finish that half for Andrew Wiggins. Meanwhile, over on ESPN, we've got 17th-ranked Iowa putting its 30-game home-winning streak against unranked opponents on the line against Ohio State. Aaron Kraft, crafty throughout.
Yeah, Kraft really showing that he can score the basketball, picking up where he left off in the Wisconsin game.
There's the defense as well, one of the best on-ball defenders up ahead to Sam Thompson. Ohio State with a 4-point lead, and Aaron Kraft 5 of 5, 2 of 2 from 3.
Hey, this is a high-scoring affair for Ohio State. We know Iowa can score, but Ohio State having over 30 points and a half is not something that they're used to.
More from Ohio State. The turnover here, and who's got the ball? It's just like a scrum. It's rugby. Aaron White finally coming out with it. Iowa with a 2-point lead at the half. Welcome into the Land Rover Halftime Report. Steve Weissman alongside Miles Simon. I was getting the stat ready. Wayne Selden, Andrew Wiggins, Joel Embiid, no points in the first half. Well, then Andrew Wiggins hits a shot from three-quarters court. Still, they're up right now with 3 points from those three.
Yeah, I mean, they're doing it defensively. They're playing fairly well, but I think you have to give a lot of credit to Baylor also. They're kind of slowing the tempo and taking Kansas out of what they want to do. They're not letting Kansas get out in transition. They're getting back in that zone and setting up and making them a half-court team.
For Baylor, though, it has come down to Brady Heslop. Had 6 threes the last time these two played, and once again, he's got 4.
Well, Heslop's one of the best at moving without the basketball. We see him on the baseline right there working against Frank Mason. Mason makes a freshman mistake. He doesn't trail the shooter. Heslop reads it. He fades to the corner, able to knock down the three. But he's the only one that's been able to be efficient in late in the first half, knocking down the threes. They have to get more production from Isaiah Austin. Corey Jefferson was a force early, but then they started doubling him big to big and really took him away.
All right, we'll see if Heslop can keep that going, or maybe Andrew Wiggins, that three, gets him going for the second half. Much more straight ahead. Kentucky looking to keep its 21-game home-winning streak alive against Marshall Henderson and Ole Miss. Plus, Florida's got a new guy.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Joseph A. Bank. We fit most everyone. JOSBank.com. You're watching the Land Rover Halftime Report.
Stephen Miles back with you. Ole Miss traveling to Lexington. Take on 18th-ranked Kentucky. They've won their last seven home games against the Rebels. But Ole Miss coming out hitting early. Sebastian Saiz. Let's take another look at that, Miles.
Beautiful drive and dish. Ole Miss came out just attacking early, mixing up their defenses. But Alex Poitras with the answer on the other end.
Marshall Henderson coming off his first back-to-back games with 20 or more points this season. When he gets going, Ole Miss is hard to stop.
And no shot is a bad shot for Marshall Henderson.
He's got eight right now. Kentucky up one at the half. It's like old Miles Simon. Every shot's a good shot.
I don't know about that.
What to watch for? Florida. They've won 13 straight SEC home games dating back to last season. Tonight, freshman Chris Walker making his highly anticipated debut against Missouri. Walker sat out 12 games, 40% of the season, because the NCAA determined he received preferential treatment from five people, including two agents. A little bit more about Walker. Well, there he is, getting set to go. 6'10", McDonald's All-American, five-star recruit. Folks have said a lot of good stuff about him. Billy Donovan said the expectations on him as a player are way, way up here. He cannot reach them. That said, Miles, how difficult is it to integrate a new guy into a team that already right now is at national caliber?
Well, I think it'll be pretty difficult because, one, he's a freshman. He's only been practicing since December, so you're having to learn a lot of things. Most practices now in December, January, are usually focused on game preparation for the most part. So now this young man has to try to fit into a team that's a national title contender, and that's going to maybe take away some of the chemistry or rhythm of this Florida Gator team, because will you get Casey Prather, Patrick Young? Some of those guys are going to lose some minutes. Now, it is a positive that he's a great rim protector, an excellent rebounder, and probably will be the best athlete on that team, so he will bring some positives, but it'll be hard to integrate him right away. Hopefully they can get some blowouts and then he can earn some minutes and really try to get a feel for the college game.
Miles, you say he's able to protect the rim. Tonight's game against Missouri, though, they feature a backcourt that just likes to shoot the ball.
Yeah, two of the best in the country, Jabari Brown and Jordan Clarkson. They score a ton of points. They're really hard to stop. Those guys score 39 of the team's 75 points per game and take 49% of the shots. Now, they've been tremendous so far in SEC play, but unfortunately, they're going against one of the best defensive teams in the country, in the Florida Gators, who only give up 57 points per game on the season. But Clarkson at 6'5", can create his own. He's a point guard. He loves to distribute to Brown, who's a big physical guard, who had 33 points against Kentucky this past weekend. And we see those numbers. They need to get some help if they want to pull off the upset and help their tournament resume from the rest of the team. But it's going to be a tall task to try to win at Florida tonight.
Yeah, and their loss to Kentucky, Frank Hayes said, it wasn't about the offense, it was the defense they needed help on. Well, right now we need more Brady Heslop threes if you're a Baylor fan. Four of those, 12 points, but his team down eight. We'll be right back.
This halftime report is presented by Land Rover. Above and beyond.
Back here in Waco as Kansas leads it at the half, and we check out our Panera Bread halftime stats. 35-27, and Kansas on the year shooting over 50%. They did it in the first half, rebounding a huge advantage, 24-12. Hey folks, John Chombi and Jimmy Dykes with you. One of the things Kansas does so well, they get offense in the paint. They didn't get a ton from Wiggins and Embiid, but that trend in the paint doing damage, that trend continued for Kansas.
Absolutely. You know what? A zone defense is designed to keep the ball away from the rim, but Kansas will have no part of it. That's who they are at their core, John. And well, they set the rules of this game early by pounding that thing inside. Perry Ellis got going with a nice runner, and their transition game was working. And just everyone that, you know, stepped onto the floor just continued to do a lot of good things, catching it, getting in a power position, and going right through the chin of Baylor around the rim. And expect a heavy dose of that from Kansas to start the second half. This guy did nothing offensively the entire first half until the last 2 seconds, and he hit a huge momentum basket for the Jayhawks.
And it's Kansas basketball up by 8 to start the second half. Great first half for Nadir Tharp with 14 points. Wide open from three and buries another. Jimmy's been great from three this year, but especially in conference.
52% and rising as a three-point shooter. I know Kansas has had some good shooters. Mario Chalmers, Sharon Collins at that point guard spot. Not any better shooter than what Nadir Tharp has been so far.
Austin inside. O'Neal the rebound, but couldn't finish.
Austin is a unique guy. For a 7-1 kid, he doesn't like to score over you. He has to get his shoulders around you and on the side of you.
Yeah, they're going to say interference. So Embiid costing Kansas, or at least it looked like he cost Kansas a bucket in that spot.
You know, Baylor's first shot, John, is not good enough to win this game. And Kansas is putting a knot on their head right now, rebounding. Remember, Baylor came in getting 42% of their misses on the year. In the first half, they got 15% of their misses. Kansas dominating on the boards.
Embiid went out to contest. Jefferson driving. And eventually Embiid the board. Kansas' biggest lead of the game, it's 11. Wiggins will try. Jeff Goodman, you get a chance to catch up with Scott Drew. What do you have to say at the break?
I did. He said they're going to change their defense a little bit, obviously, to try to limit Nadir Tharp's effectiveness. Instead of going under the ball screens, they're going to go over them to make it tougher for him to take those three-point shots.
Well, Baylor's got to figure out a solution on the offensive end. They missed their last six field goals. And a foul inside. If it's on Embiid, it's his third.
John, I mentioned in the first half that when you take on a shot blocker and a presence like Embiid, it can't be a steady dose of just allowing him to stay around the rim. You have to move him. Go back and watch the San Diego State game when San Diego State won in Fog Allen. They moved Joel Embiid the last three or four minutes and made him recover, and therefore he got out of position and they got offensive rebounds. Watch the Iowa State game. They did a good dose of dragging him away and making him do something out on the floor. Texas, even with Ridley, your game on Saturday, a couple of his fouls were caused by Ridley dragging him away from the rim and then making a hard rim dive, and he fouled recovering. You can't let him camp out.
Brown trying to get going here at the Farrell Center. They tried the lob for Wiggins. Wow, he was able to get up there and get it eventually. Black ended up with it. And then inside, Ellis puts it home. Perry Ellis with a dozen.
And you're right, though. The first catch by Wiggins was special.
Jefferson is fouled on the jump shot by Tarik Black. Black, his second foul. Jimmy, Baylor at the offensive end shooting 36%. You saw the win on Saturday, despite the fact that their point guard didn't play. It would seem that long term, Kenny Cherry not playing a lot is going to be a real detriment to their offense.
Yeah, it is. You know, now there's a ton of pressure on Heslop in this ball game to get free. You know, Bills himself talked about how they're going to defend him in the second half. Can Baylor score the ball around the rim? If they can, they can fight their way back in. If they can't, Kansas is going to continue to extend this lead. And now would be a time to do it with Embiid on the bench.
Ellis inside. And they get a foul on Isaiah Austin. Nope, beg your pardon. That one on O'Neal.
Hey John, this is my week to tour the Big 12 in Stillwater on Saturday and here tonight and at Norman this coming Saturday, Baylor at Oklahoma.
It's good to have you here in the Big 12.
Well, what I like about this league has offensive personality. When you look at Iowa State and how they play, Oklahoma State, how they play, Oklahoma. Kansas has personality, how they pound you inside.
O'Neal gets a good look at it. He buries it. 6-point game. A turnover, Baylor basketball. And Bill Self's going to call a timeout. Well, Super Tuesday continues. Third-ranked Florida taking on Missouri, and that's 9 Eastern over on ESPN. Missouri-Florida tonight, 9 on ESPN. Also live on Watch ESPN. Heslop. Yeah, Brady Heslop in this one with 4 3-pointers. He's been the guy knocking down the outside shots. Baylor, a little bit like Kansas, when things are going well, they get it in close.
Well, they're a little bit like everybody else across the country. That's the formula for how you have winning basketball. You score at the free throw stripe, you score at the rim, and then you take wide open threes. And if you get that out of balance, it's hard to win hard games.
Only 10 points in the paint tonight for the Bears. And Seldon the other way, able to put it home.
John, think about this. Kansas in first place in the league, right? Coming in tonight, they've taken 198 free throws and 129 threes. Baylor has that backwards. They've taken more threes than free throws.
You know, the clock has not been running. And I mean, it's been for a bit now. Yeah, they're going to need to look at video, but the clock was not running during that entire possession. I'm wondering how much time they missed. I mean, they're going to get it right, but I mean, I think it may be close to
like a minute.
A minute a game
that
time.
That long.
So Mark Whitehead over there along with Tom Eads as they get things straightened out. 8-point game here in Waco.
Look at that. It never started. There's a ways to go here. Boom.
All right, that wasn't a minute. No. That wasn't even close to a minute, but yeah.
The guy knocking down the outside shots. Baylor.
It may not have even been going
prior to that. You did see on that replay, though, all that we're talking about the clock.
Yeah, the referees did not see the entire replay. So Tom Eads is over there being told, and Mark Whitehead doesn't know it yet, but they need to look again. They got to watch it, the whole thing, just to see how much time. ESPN. Yeah, so it's going to take a little bit. They're going to have to do the stopwatch again. And then again, remember, it didn't start here. Now you get the lob. Yeah. So we're still stuck right there at 16:42. Yeah, maybe it was close to.
Well, I'm counting around 28 or 29 seconds just watching the footage there. They'll have a stopwatch they can put on it.
at the official scorer's table. A backup timing device is part of the requirements for that table over there.
If you're at home and you want to Tebow us, tweet us your guesses on the time. So they're going to say 16:05. So it ended up being, I think we're at 16:42. It'll be 37 seconds. That's without a calculator. And it's still not running.
Either the clock's broke or the operator's broke.
Yeah.
It's one of the two.
So now Mark Whitehead and Tom Eads back over to the table. Now, you see problems like this from time to time. A lot of times, it's something to do with those boxes that the referees have. Yeah, and that's what it is. Mark Whitehead just told us. If you see those little things that look like beepers on the referee's belts, they actually stop the clock as soon as the whistle blows. And right now, those devices are not working. Feed inside. That works. Corey Jefferson.
And John, that's what I'm talking about. When Embiid's not on the floor, Baylor has a chance now to cut into this lead. They can just throw the top, which is a much smaller Kansas defense.
Wiggins pulls up. And out of bounds, it'll be Baylor basketball.
Remember, Wiggins shooting 24% for the year as a jump shooter off the bounce. That's not his strength. Here's what I'm talking about. There's no double team. And Corey Jefferson just runs to the front of the rim. 7-footer to 6'10". Baylor hanging in the ball game.
Kansas by 6. John Chambi, Jimmy Dykes. All right, Jimmy, let's talk about putting on those glasses. What are you seeing?
Well, here's what I see. I'm waiting on Marcus Smart to become the most competitive dude in college basketball like he was last year. He has to do that for Oklahoma State. I salute Travis Bader, the new career three-point shooter in all of college basketball. I believe in the Florida Gators are good enough to win the whole thing, and I'd be surprised if Wichita State gets beat. This is their toughest week coming up right now at Indiana State and at Northern Iowa. I will be surprised if they go down. They will be unbeaten at the end of regular season.
All right. That's what Jimmy D sees. Austin inside. Puts that home.
Baylor's doing exactly what the formula says to do with Embiid on the bench. They're not trying to get back in this ball game by taking quick shots or bad shots. They're going at the rim.
4-point game. Wiggins right at Austin and draws the foul. You know, I talked about that device, the belt pack that they wear, the referees. They actually, Mark Whitehead and company took them off. Now, again, it's a device that syncs up with the clock that when the whistle blows, clock stops. But it was not working, so they take them off. They're going to do the clock manually. And those devices, they wear them in college and in the NBA. People may not know that there's not someone actually running the clock.
Is that something a new set of AA batteries could correct for us? Where's Jeff Goodman? We'll get Jeff to get on that at the next timeout.
Yeah. Hey, did you guys make sure you had a fresh set of batteries in there? I'm thinking they got that covered.
That would be my first common sense thought, though.
Right. And possession arrow, it belongs to Kansas. As Austin and Black wrestle for it.
John, we have to remember, Baylor is a desperate team. I said it Saturday. Desperate teams in February are dangerous teams. They're not going to let go of the rope easily. They know their season hangs possibly tonight, and can they win at Oklahoma on Saturday?
Well, give the piece of information that you led with in our broadcast, sub-500 in this league. Well, trying to get at large.
Well, here's the deal. Over the last 5 years, we've only had five teams earn an at-large bid that finished below 500 in their league. That's the pressure that Baylor faces them right now. Can it be done? Yes. We got to remember, Baylor right now in this league, they're 2-6 coming into tonight.
And a travel as Austin turns it over.
mean, it's one thing to be below 500 and get an at-large, but you lose tonight, you're 2-7. It's going to take a furious finish in order to even get near 500. And now Embiid comes back on the court with three fouls. And what will Scott Drew kind of do, try to do to him the next time that Baylor has the basketball? Embiid wasn't able to get that to go. I think Gathers may have gotten a piece, not sure. And Franklin fouled on the floor. You know, Jimmy, we talk about Wiggins and Embiid being quiet. It's also worth noting that another guy who's supplied a lot of scoring for them, especially in conference play, has been quiet tonight, and that is Wayne Selden. He's got 2 points. Wiggins blocks that one from behind. Now up ahead to Wiggins. At Austin flies in and he's fouled.
Well, that's a great example, the best one in this ball game of who this kid really is. Again, he's shooting 70% on the year in transition. And he gets an average of 4.1 points per transition play, and he gets rewarded a free throw 32% of the time in transition. He can get from 20 feet to the rim on 2 steps as quick as anybody we have in the college game for a guy 6'8".
3 fouls on Austin. And Wiggins 1-for-8 in this one. He was 2-for-12 on Saturday. Lead back to 7 for Kansas. So
why is Kansas in the lead with those numbers we've talked about from Wiggins and Embiid and Selden? Well, they're up 12 or 13 on the board. So they're winning the power part of the floor.
Good hands by Tharp. Franklin gets it back. And they're going to say goaltending.
Watch Wiggins, what I'm talking about. From 20 feet and down in transition, one bounce, now no more bounces. Watch this. He picks it up, 1-2, and gets himself all the way to the rim. And there's very few at this level that can make the play that he just made.
Wiggins feeds Embiid. Joel Embiid in this one still has not scored. Prince shot contested. I think that's number 4 on Joel Embiid.
Yep. And there he is again, fouling, recovering as a defender. Got him on the move a little bit. He has not had the discipline so far in his freshman year as a recovering defender to not foul. Great recovery speed and length, but the discipline now is the next step.
And Tark, Black checks back in.
John, that's a big foul now. Because what Baylor did when he was on the bench, they need to go right back to it. Throw the ball inside.
Selden was calling for it in the corner. Ball has yet to get below the free throw line extended. And Tharp drills that one. He's got 20.
That was bad offense. Ended with a great shot. There was nothing good about that offensive series with the exception of Tharp just jumps up and sticks one.
Wiggins. Gathers gets the block, but he also got the body. And Wiggins back to the line.
A really good give up of the basketball by Nadir Tharp in transition. And the play before, again, the ball never got below the free throw line extended. The zone was never flattened out. And Nadir Tharp just had to jump up and take a shot clock pressure jump shot.
Tharp
shooting 45% from three coming in, even better in conference. O'Neal back in, Jefferson back in. Kansas is a team that gets to the line a ton. They've shot only 11 free throws in this game, 6 out of 11 from the stripe. Average getting to the line just about 27 times per game. And that leads the conference.
Heslip stuck his head underneath the rim, and that's a sure sign that he's coming out one side or the other.
That's the little jet cut for him. Kansas walked through it this afternoon. They covered up well. Shot clock winding down. Black. And O'Neal getting the rebound. Heslip puts it on the floor. And he stepped on the baseline. Turnover, Kansas. 7-point game here in Waco on Super Tuesday, and the home team desperately needing a win.
Steve Weiss from Miles Simon here. Kentucky hosting Ole Miss over on ESPNU. Julius Randle didn't start the second half, but when he got in, he did things like this.
Yeah, it seems to be extremely motivated by the benching.
7 points for him right now. Kentucky up 10 over on ESPN. Iowa falling by 5 to Ohio State as Aaron Kraft leads the way with 14 points. Back to Waco.
All right, guys, and ESPN's journey to the tourney continues Thursday. Battle in the Pac-12. You get Oregon and number 2 Arizona. It's Thursday live on ESPN. Also on Watch ESPN. So Pac-12 basketball coming your way. That one on Thursday, part of our journey to the tourney. Right here on Super Tuesday, it's Kansas leading Baylor by 7. John Shambi, Jimmy Dykes, and Jeff Goodman here in Waco. As Tarik Black corrals a defensive rebound.
What a good job by Black to blow up the hip of Rico Gathers when that ball was on the rim.
It's been a tough night for Wiggins. 1 out of 9.
Talking to Jeff Goodman at halftime about best shooters in college basketball right now. He put together a pretty good list that I would agree with. The Rogge kid from Creighton, Nick Stauskas from Michigan, Phil Forte from Oklahoma State, this kid Heslip from Baylor. Bader, I talked about, as a new career three-point shooter. Nick Johnson at Arizona, I think that, you know, I trust his shot about as much as anybody right now as well.
Franklin off the mark, inside, and Gathers his foul. And Gathers will go to the line and get a chance to chip away at that Kansas lead. Jeff Goodman, by the way, wants to add one more to his list. What do you got?
I got Jabari Brown, guys. Ooh. 48% overall. How about in league play, 58%. Jimmy, you got to get him on there.
Yeah, good call. Plus he's 6'5", so he can make guarded shots. And he has a very unique, just a slight lean back on his shot. Jabari Brown from Missouri, you'll see him tonight at Florida. Another, well, there's a lot of good shooters this year. When you start really breaking it down, Doug McDermott can shoot that ball. And Baylor needs more out of Heslip and more out of Gathers. Those are two guys to me that I would not want off the floor if I'm a Baylor Bear. I would want Gathers and Heslip on the floor as much as they can play.
And they've been coming off the bench for most of the year.
Baylor's still only getting 22% of their missed shots in this game. 20 percentage points lower than normal.
Seldon maybe a little out of control there. Off balance shot. Ten to go in this one as Jefferson draws the foul, was looking for the and one opportunity.
Normally that's a play they run for Brady Heslip to send him inside to be a size screener, a mismatch, so you can't switch it. That time I believe it was Franklin who ran inside to get Jefferson posted up on the block. I just don't think John Jefferson and Austin for sure, they don't fight for deep post touches. They give up too easily and catch the ball one big step off the lane as opposed to right in the lane like Gathers would.
Isaiah Austin was a huge recruit, and last year was a guy that was much more comfortable facing up and more specifically operating away from the basket. He's worked hard to try and do his work in closer. As Gathers got tied up and ended up being fouled by Frank Mason. There's a mean old look on Gathers' face. Got ourselves a one and one spot right here. Gathers 57%. Tharp did a good job hanging on to that.
Perry Ellis back in the ball game. He's been good in this game. 5 out of 7 from the field. Very efficient with what he's done offensively. Now part of that X game on the inside of the zone along with Black.
Wiggins steps back, drills a three.
One of the few that he makes off the bounce, though. At that time, it was a very simple rhythm dribble, had a lot of time to measure the rim, shot it with ease and confidence.
Gathers inside, contested, no calls. He went down. Wiggins, oh, my goodness. Be careful, don't hit your head on the rim.
And he dunked that ball with 31 on the shot clock. And 4 or 5 times in this game, Baylor has stood and watched Kansas run it right up their backside. This cat in transition is lethal. He is a bona fide NBA big-time guy in the open floor. Now, the rest of his game, obviously, he has some growing and some learning to do. But you're getting loose in the open floor against any level athlete right now in the world, and he can get it done.
Yeah, the explosiveness is pretty obscene. And Mason is fouled by Cherry. This is a dangerous spot right now for Baylor. 8:33 to go, and Kansas back out in front by double figures. It was the 5th team foul on Baylor, 17 fouls on Kansas. So out of bounds. Talked about how quiet Wiggins has been. He scored 9 of Kansas's last 12.
There's, again, that X action inside. Black and Ellis, all they're doing is playing off of each other and Xing inside the zone.
Austin, a rare three, and inside a foul. Got that one on Jefferson, his first.
John, I go back to it. The number of three-point shots that Baylor has taken is more than the number of free throw attempts they've taken in Big 12 play. And that cannot be the case. That number is holding true tonight. They've taken more threes than free throws. That tells you they settle too much for the perimeter game instead of being determined to pound that thing inside and get power points.
Still more hoops for you here on Super Tuesday over on ESPN. Coming up at 9 Eastern, it'll be Missouri and number 3 Florida. That's tonight at 9. You can also check it out on Watch ESPN. All right, Let's go, Mr. Pilot. I want to check out Jimmy's jet. Is this a nice jet?
Oh, man, new leather seats this year. We rolled it out in the studio last week. This is just the Big 12 version of the jet. Kansas will be up there in first class as a one or two seed, I firmly believe, before it's all said and done. I think Texas and Iowa State will have a very good business class seat, probably on the aisle with a lot of leg room. They're going to be fine. In coach right now, I think more towards the back of the plane. Oklahoma State is playing their way now towards the back of the plane. But they would be in the field along with Kansas State and Oklahoma. Baylor's on standby. A win tonight, I would be tempted to slide them to the very back row of the plane. Not a good seat, but they'd be on. But then if they lose the next game, I'd slide them right back off. That's how poorly they have played up to this point. But at least they're at the airport, they're through security, and they have a chance right now with 8 minutes to go to do more damage.
Well, let's not kid ourselves. We travel a lot. No one wants to be on standby.
Oh, my goodness.
What a pass.
I'm talking about the pass that Tharp threw. You have to be a very good shooter to throw a pass that far with that much accuracy.
That was a rainbow, and Wiggins, who can jump out of the gym, was able to handle it. Big three there, Kenny Cherry.
Bad shooters can't make that pass that Tharp just made. And Bill Self knows it, so he gets his best shooter, Tharp, 30 feet away to throw it.
Tharp with the rainbow, and it'll go 22 now for Nadir Tharp.
He has really played well. He's talked, he's been vocal. He's had great body language. As an upperclassman guard. And Andrew Wiggins, he ended the first half with a shot from half court. And that got him going. The heat started rising. In transition, he is phenomenal. And around the rim, watch the pass by Tharp. From 30 feet away, dead on. Well done, Mr. Tharp.
Back in Waco on Super Tuesday, and number 8, Kansas on top of Baylor. And a large part of the reason, Nadir Tharp.
Well, he's been outstanding. 4 assists, 2 turnovers, 22 points. He's only missed 2 of his 6 three-point shots. And he's played with, he really has played to a terrific speed. He's done anything he's wanted. He's taken the ball to the spot on the floor when he wants to take it and when he has to take it. And he's jumped up and he's made guarded shots in this ball game. I said earlier, I firmly believe Tharp and Mason are good enough for Kansas to win a national title this year. Now, I don't think either one of them, I know neither one of them, are in the same class with Tyler Ennis from Syracuse, Fred VanVleet from Wichita, Scotty Wilbekin from Florida. To me, those three guys jump out at me in terms of a lead guard that can lead a team to a national title. But Tharp is good enough to take Kansas all the way to the Final Four himself.
He's made a huge improvement. Last year, one of their top reserves, but now been really anchoring this team. And they're interesting to watch in this spot, basically two point guards in the court with both Mason and Tharp.
That's because Tharp shoots it so well. You can slide him down to the two guard.
O'Neal stepped right into the passing lane.
Kansas stops the ball and they find Hessler. Item 1 and 2 in your transition defense.
And inside a foul on Baylor, they get it on O'Neal.
Well, Baylor was almost setting moving screens in the first half to free up Hessler, and that one was a no-brainer. I mean, O'Neal just leveled Mason as Mason was caboosing the shooter.
I'm sorry, he was what?
Caboosing the shooter.
Okay. Like the caboose on a train, you're saying.
Stay attached. All over the track. Just running his tracks. You say that as a guy that's never been caboosed as a shooter.
I'm just, look, we haven't, you know, it's been a little while, and everyone's, I need a just sort of a.
I haven't seen you since Mal.
That's what I mean. Yeah, I need a Jimmy Dykes refresher
draw
course.
Draw you back in. Yeah. Draw you back in.
Mason inside, lost the handle. And Hessler comes away with it. Heslop in the first half with a big shooting 20 minutes. That one in and out. Well, they've made Heslop put the ball on the deck, and that's exactly what you have to do. Bill Self said enough of him getting daylight as a three-point shooter. Heslop had four threes in the first half, 12 points, hasn't scored since the break. Nice move inside by Tarn Black. The Memphis transfer has been asked to play more minutes tonight with Embiid in foul trouble.
Baylor has to fight back right now, or that win at Oklahoma State all of a sudden gets negated quickly, and they go to 2-7. And that last defensive possession, there was not a lot of fight out of these guys in white.
Austin spinning, draws the foul, and he'll shoot two. So under five to go, a 13-point game.
Austin has struggled in this game with the length of Kansas. It's odd, again, he's 7-1, but he doesn't like to score over the top of people. He wants to pivot and maneuver to get his shoulders around you and kind of score on the side of you. And Kansas doing a good job of leveling him off and not letting him get those kind of looks in this game. Beautiful kid with a brave, courageous story that he shared a few weeks ago, huh?
Yeah, amazing. Where's that prosthetic eye, the right eye, an injury suffered in junior high. First suffered it playing baseball and then re-injured playing basketball. Four different surgeries. That's why he wears the goggles. Think about the challenge as far as shooting a basketball with one eye.
You know, Jeff Goodman has followed him for a long time. And Jeff watched him play back in high school. And Jeff, where has he gotten better? Talking about Isaiah Austin, because I thought he was kind of stuck this year when the year began.
You know, believe it or not, he's gotten tougher. And I know a lot of people would say he's still a little bit soft, but Isaiah Austin has gotten tougher. I talked to him in the offseason. He was going to go pro if not for that shoulder injury. He told me he was gone. And you know what? He probably needs to stay at least another year. He's not ready for the NBA.
That shoulder injury you alluded to, off-season surgery on his labrum. Things a little sloppy at the moment. Scott Drew's team down by 11, and there's under four to go.
And to follow up Jeff's point, you know what? There's absolutely nothing wrong with not being ready yet for the NBA. Doesn't matter if Embiid feels that in his heart, that he's not ready yet, or Isaiah Austin, or whoever you want to throw in there. It's okay. It's okay. Humble guys make better decisions than prideful guys. In basketball and in life.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by the new 2014 Scion TC. It's a knockout.
Steve Weissman in studio over on ESPN right now. Ohio State and Iowa. Aaron Kraft done a little bit of everything today. The pass to Shannon Scott. The Hawkeyes won in Columbus January 12th. Buckeyes looking to win in Iowa City. They are up five. Following that game, it's the debut of Chris Walker. Dickie V going to talk him up. Yeah, he's a diaper dandy. Freshman for the Gators taking on Missouri. 13 minutes from tip. Back to Waco.
So Embiid at the line. And again, Super Tuesday continues on ESPN Missouri and Florida. Joel Embiid still has not scored in this one.
Has he had a game yet this year where he has not scored?
Yeah, double checking on that.
Or one.
Yeah. His fewest this year against Duke. He had two.
Well, he's halfway there. Look at it on the bright side. Still. With special talent, and when he decides to come out, I don't care if it's this year or next year, I think he'll be the number one pick.
Prince now. Oh, that was halfway down. Gathers flying in.
gathers, powering his way to the rim and puts it in. Good job by Rico Gathers. A sprint out ball screen action. After the ball handler cleared, he dove hard with a purpose. Embiid, and one. Nice play by the big guy.
It shows some emotion. Are you talking about 7 feet tall? Pretty good body control right there.
I love his passion at the end. First 2 points of the game. He's got 2:47 to go. And he comes up swinging. You're right, a 7-1 guy with agility to concentrate, keep his chin locked in on the rim. And told me it's a 23-hour plane ride from Cameroon when he came to the United States for the first time. Was not in first class. Exit row aisle.
Ouch. 7 feet tall.
Long time to sit, isn't it?
Yeah.
Hard hit by Embiid to recover.
Big rebound by Ellis. Kansas ball up by 13. And again in the second half, Heslop has been a non-factor. Has not scored. Ellis spins. And Embiid inside.
Seldom will Bill Self let his team get beat by your best option. In that first half, it was Brady Heslop. So Bill Self said in the second half, we're going to chase this dude. We're going to tag him and caboose him and run him off the three-point line. And there better not be any daylight when number five catches the basketball and rises up to shoot. So they forced Heslop to dribble 3 or 4 times in the second half, and the Baylor offense came to a standstill.
Now, Jimmy, it's a 13-point game, 2:10 to go. Baylor's 14-7, 2-6 in the league. They're the defending NIT champs. They want to get back to the NCAA tournament. You fall to 14-8 and 2-7. I mean, really hard to imagine them making the NCAA tournament.
Well, it is. And I thought it was very interesting that our ESPN research staff did a great job this morning when I reached out to them. How many teams the last 5 years have earned an at-large bid by finishing below 500 in conference play? And the answer was 5. And that's exactly what Baylor is going to be looking at. If they don't get hot in a hurry and get on a streak.
Franklin, a little off balance. And they're in a tough spot right here. And their season in a precarious position also.
But John, I'm telling you, when you can win on the road in conference play against a Baylor team that has top 25 talent and Joel Embiid basically does nothing for you other than foul, and Wiggins did nothing in the first half, that's the sign of a strong team that can beat you in a lot of ways. And Kansas clamped down defensively, and this team going forward will continue to get better. Bill Self's teams always get better during the month of February and March, especially on the defensive end of the floor. And he will not let up on these guys because he knows he has the pieces to win another national championship.
This team's so inexperienced coming in and relying on the freshmen in Seldon and Embiid and Wiggins, Mason as well. Contemplate for a second, they returned 2 guys that played double-figure minutes last year, Tharp and Perry Ellis. Austin tries another 3. He's got a good touch, tracks down the rebound.
It's almost like we come to expect it from Bill Self. But here's a guy that replaces all 5 starters, correct? And he has the number 8 team in the country that I think is going to win their 10th Big 12 title in a row and be a threat to win the whole thing. And his name never yet pops up as a potential national coach of the year because we've come to expect it of him. Who's done a better job from the end of last year to where we are now, considering what they lost and what the product that he's put on the floor and the number 1 RPI, the number 1 strength of schedule so far in the country?
Well, they've gone out of conference to play tough teams, and in conference, this is the Big 12 by RPI, the toughest league in the land. A schedule, if you will, bathing in top 25 teams, and a credit that Bill Self will take on all comers. 18-point advantage all of a sudden, or I should say, yeah, 18.
I told you at noon, it wouldn't surprise me if Baylor won by 20. It wouldn't surprise me if Kansas won by 20 or anything in between. And ultimately, it's going to be Kansas putting a whooping on Baylor. Now, where does Baylor go from here? They go to Oklahoma on Saturday. The schedule does ease up a little bit for them, but you talk about a team that has probably underperformed as much as anybody in the country considering where they began the season as a ranked club.
So in Norman on Saturday, and that's not particularly easy.
Nope.
And TCU, K-State, still have Oklahoma State and Texas, two other toughies left. You and I, we talked about being in Maui together. We saw Baylor in Maui, and they looked like a very good team. They ended up losing to Syracuse in the championship game of the Maui Classic.
And it's hard to put your finger on what's wrong with Baylor's team right now. You know, they're not great defensively in their man or their zone. It was primarily zone tonight. I mean, offensively, their point guard play to me just does nothing for me. Franklin was good the other day in Stillwater, but that's been the exception, not the rule. Kenny Cherry's been in single digits now, 7 out of his last 10 ball games. Not strong enough around the rim. And now their fourth straight home loss, right, for
yep.
Baylor?
They have lost four in a row here at the Farrell Center. Well, Kansas able to bounce back big time from Saturday's loss in Austin. Nadir Tharp, one off his career high with 22. And Kansas wins it 69-52. Impressive stuff from Bill Self's team in control for the entire second half. 69-52, our final coming up next.